These types of disputes have repercussions for taxpayers it may affect the implementation of important governmental policies. Accordingly, it is in the interest of the public that these disputes and the outcome of these disputes become known to the public, and that the public body and its responsible officers are held accountable. By keeping these kinds of public-private disputes and their resolution private and confidential, the public is deprived of the opportunity to consider what went wrong and to attribute accountability to either the public body or to the private party. Unquote. We can understand the case of confidentiality with respect to arbitration involving two private persons. However, the case for confidentiality with respect to arbitration involving the government is more difficult to justify. The values of transparency, probity, accountability, and public participation in governmental affairs animate the Constitution of the Republic of Ghana. These values, as well as the right to information, are undermined if the government, if disputes involving the government are resolved behind closed doors. They are equally undermined if the awards resulting from arbitration are made inaccessible to the public for scrutiny and debate. Happily, the High Court of Ghana has held that, I'm quoting, the individual does not need a Freedom of Information Act to enjoy the right to information in Ghana. However, there is no doubt that enacting the Right to Information Bill would provide greater clarity on this issue. So this letter supports the call on Parliament to expedite the enactment of the Right to Information Bill, which has been pending before Parliament for more than a decade.
Legal fees and the slides are very small, but the
what may be doing that better to the patient, and then last following year we will see information on that. For example, in the Gustav MW Premise Arbitration, in which all the claimants claim were estates, claims were estates, each party for their own legal fees and expenses, plus half the cost of the arbitration. It is therefore important that to the extent that it is possible, the government avoids international arbitration or reduce the possibility of claims being brought against it. This can be done through
when the request for arbitration is served for entity.
The respondent states can then quickly act to become familiar with the underlying facts of the claim, gather the relevant documentation and witnesses, secure the relevant bureaucratic authorizations to appoint domestic or foreign counsel and funding for the arbitration, as well as select an arbitrator. Unfortunately, in especially developing countries such as Ghana, all this may be caught up in complicated and inefficient bureaucratic systems. The rules of arbitration institutions often do not contain any special provisions, acknowledging the unique circumstances governments face in defending claims that are brought against them. It is therefore unsurprising that requests for extension of time were frequently made by the government of Ghana in the arbitration awards revealed for this lecture. The appointment of experienced counsel and consultants, requests for extension of time, and developing international arbitration expertise within the Attorney General's Department can go a long way in helping to overcome these challenges of legal representation and participation in international arbitration. Let's turn my attention to the nature of the disputes and the awards. Most of the disputes involving the government have been substantially grounded in claims for expropriation, breach of contract and unjust enrichment, and breach of international law obligations. Occasionally, there have been claims in tort, breach of administrative law and alleged human rights violations. However, most of these claims were either dismissed or did not result in significant awards against the government. In reviewing the awards, it is clear that some of the arbitration claims were founded on decisions taken by government to terminate contracts entered into by previous governments. For example, the project agreement in the Dupal Continental Gold Rush arbitration was executed on 1984-1985 under President John Jerry Robinson's administration. The agreement was terminated in November 2005 under President John Ekumpo's government. The construction pioneers agreement was executed on 3 December 1996, that is 2 days before the presidential elections of that year. It appears the agreement worked well under the second term of President Rawlinson's government, but the relationship became sour when President Prof's government assumed office in 2001. The bank switch agreement was executed on December 12, 2007, under the second term of President Prof's government. It appears after the transition to President Mills' government, bank switch relationship with the government became a difficult one. It ultimately resulted in their successful claim for breaches of contract. The Balkan agreement was signed on 27 July 2007 under President Prof's government. The issues that gave rise to the Balkan arbitration occurred under President Mills' government. Finally, the Star Times agreement was executed on 11 April 2012 under President Mills' government. It was terminated on 14 January 2015 under President John Dramani Mahama's government. It is not being suggested in these examples that the government has no right to review, renegotiate, terminate, or otherwise deal with contracts entered into with foreign investors by their predecessors. No, taking such a position will place an inappropriate and intolerable limitation on governmental powers and policy space. These examples, however, raise the question whether the various governmental actions that grounded the respective international arbitration claims could have been avoided or recalled. As I have already noted, the political urge to undo what the previous government had done that is endemic in Ghana should be resisted by government officials. In many of the arbitration claims that have been brought against the government, the underlying transaction was expressly governed by Ghanaian law. A significant shortfall of some of the awards was the treatment of Ghanaian law. A shocking example of deviation from Ghanaian law occurred in one of the construction pioneers arbitration chaired by Dr. Van Blessing. In it, the government argued that it was entitled to statutory settlement on the basis of the Financial Administration Decree 1979 and the Financial Administration Act 2003. Remarkably, even though the contract between the parties was expressly governed by Ghanaian law, the majority of the tribunal, with Dr. S.K.B. Asante dissenting, concluded that these statutes are not within the ambit of the party's choice of law in favor of Ghanaian law. This was because, according to the majority, the application of the statutes would undermine the investors' claims. The majority were concerned that the legislation provided the government with unilateral settlement, with neither an opportunity for judicial review nor a similar power provided to the private party. Without doubt, no piece of Ghanaian law has generated more analysis and controversy in arbitration involving the government than Article 1815 of the Constitution. How arbitral laws have treated this provision and the jurisprudence of the Supreme Court on it is a classic example of the tension that arises when national law is applied in an international forum or setting. In one of the construction pioneers arbitration, the Balkan arbitration, and the Bank arbitration, the tribunals ignored and did not give effect to the well-known jurisprudence of the Supreme Court on Article 1815. This was so even though Ghanaian law was the applicable law to the contract underlying all the claims. A clear message should be sent to all international arbitrators that it's important they take Ghanaian law seriously. This is especially so where in the government contract, Ghanaian law is designated as the applicable law. A recent example of a tribunal taking Ghanaian law seriously is the water bill arbitration. In this partial award of jurisdiction, the tribunal applied the full measure of Ghanaian law. The tribunal applied the jurisprudence of the decision of the Supreme Court that the contracts at issue were unconstitutional contracts and hence void and unenforceable. With words that should hopefully resonate with future tribunals, the tribunal noted, and I'm quoting, "In the tribunal's view, it is beyond doubt that the Supreme Court of Ghana is vested with exclusive jurisdiction to deal with constitutional or public interest matters. Such matters, therefore, would be beyond the jurisdiction of this tribunal," unquote. In a 2002 article, Mr. Emmanuel Yaobene undertook a broad, detailed, and exceptional review of the jurisprudence of international arbitral tribunals. He observed that what is striking about the jurisprudence is the central concern for the protection of the foreign investor or enterprise, at times even significantly beyond rights available to states under international law. I submit that overall, most of the awards I examined for this lecture were generally fair, both procedurally and substantively. The awards were detailed and well-reasoned. The exercise of discretion, such as in awarding costs, was reasonable in most instances. The parties were given reasonable opportunity to present their cases, including exceptions of kind. Where damages were awarded, the assessment or quantification of damages was thorough and often significantly less than what the claimant was originally claiming. I did not notice, from a review of the awards, a perceptible pro-claimant or pro-respondent bias in the awards. 12 claims against the government that have resulted in final or partial awards were reviewed for this sector. Of the 12, the government of Ghana wholly or partly won 7, either on grounds of lack of jurisdiction or on the merits. Of the 6 that the government of Ghana wholly or partly lost, there is no doubt that in respect of 3, the lack of effective representation and participation in the arbitration process were among the principal reasons for the loss or the extent of the loss. These 3 are the 2 construction pioneers arbitrations and the Bantry arbitration. It is very likely that the outcome of these arbitrations would have been different if the government had effective legal representation right from the start of the proceedings. Now turn my attention to the enforcement of arbitration awards against the government. When an arbitration award is made against the government, and Ghana does not voluntarily comply with the award, the successful party can enforce the award in Ghana or outside Ghana through the courts. Because the government has assets or properties abroad, it is more likely that the successful claimant would seek enforcement of the award in those foreign countries where the government has assets. Indeed, enforcement outside Ghana is legally and practically more viable than enforcement in Ghana. There have been instances in which award creditors have sought to enforce arbitration awards against the government in various courts outside Ghana. For example, in the construction finance arbitrations, the claimants attempted to enforce the awards in Belgium, France, and the United States. However, the settlement that was reached in March 2010 resulted in the abatement of those proceedings. More recently, the claimant in the Balkan arbitration has sought to enforce this award in the United States. According to the claimant, I'm quoting from the petition, "The Republic of Ghana has refused to pay any of the amount imposed under the award," or quote. In fact, on the 29th of June 2017, while the U.S. action was pending, the claimant was able to obtain an order from a South African High Court attaching the shares of the government of Ghana in Anglo-Gold Ashanti. The construction pioneer settlement, the petition to confirm the Opong award in the United States, and the order from the South African High Court with respect to the Balkan award, reveal that in both disputes, the government did not satisfy the awards immediately after they were issued. This failure to satisfy the awards on time has allowed significant interest to accumulate on the awards and resulted in significant financial loss to the state. For example, at the time of the construction pioneer settlement, in March 2010, the awards dating back to 2004 and other undisputed but unpaid claims have reached 162 million euros and was accruing interest at a rate of 12,700 euros a day. In 2010, the Attorney General negotiated the global settlement of 94 million euros to settle all the CP claims. In the Balkan arbitration, the award ordered the government to pay $11.7 million plus cost and interest to Balkan Energy Ghana Limited. As at the time the petition to confirm the award was filed on the 31st of March 2017 in Washington, D.C., the amount due was $13.3 million. This represents an increase of $1.5 million since the tribunal award was issued in April 2014. As far as I know, at present, it appears the bank's wage award of $187 million has not been satisfied by the government. There is no record of an attempt to challenge the award at the seat of arbitration, which is the Netherlands. The award was issued on the 11th of April 2014. At a conservative interest rate of 5%, the award debt currently stands at 217 million cedis. That is an increase of over 20 million cedis between 2014 and today. There appears to be no good reason for Ghana to be saddled with these additional debt resulting from the accumulation of interest. If Ghana wanted to challenge the awards in order to have them set aside, annulled or suspended, it should have immediately done that following the date the awards were issued by the tribunal. Like a judgment debt, an arbitration award attracts interest at a rate defined in the award. It was thus certain that if the government did not satisfy these awards, the amounts would increase. In fact, as demonstrated above, they have. These are certainly avoidable debts. Once again, we see here classic examples of situations in which the procrastinating or delinquent conduct of government has resulted in significant financial loss to the state. It's important that the government avoid this in future. There is no gain saying that it's rare for courts to refuse to enforce international arbitration awards. The grounds on which enforcement may be refused are limited and very narrowly construed. Indeed, even when enforcement is denied in one country, the award creditor is free to seek enforcement in another country where the government of Ghana has assets. This can result in needless and prolonged litigation, with the award debt increasing in size through the accumulation of interest, not to mention the legal cost involved in defending such enforcement proceedings. It is important the government of Ghana is best represented in international arbitration proceedings. However, when despite such representation, an award is made against the government, it is equally important that the government does one of two things. First, it must take immediate steps to challenge the award if there are legally viable grounds for challenging the awards. Or second, if no such grounds are present, it must satisfy the awards by paying off the debt. This will avoid unnecessary and costly accumulation of interest on the debt. As Cephalos suggested in Plato's Republic, and I'm quoting, "Justice is paying one's debt," unquote. Now turn my attention to my conclusion. Fellows of the Academy, distinguished invited guests, my brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, it is an undeniable fact that on many occasions the government of Ghana has had international commercial intercourse with foreign investors. Some of the transactions emanating from such commercial engagements have resulted in disputes. Some of the disputes have been settled through international arbitration. The number of such disputes appears to be on the rise. This should be a matter of significant concern to the state. This is because, as demonstrated in this lecture, whether the government wins or loses in such disputes, the financial cost to the state can be very burdensome. This inaugural lecture has not advocated the removal of government contracts from the international arbitration sphere entirely. The realities of modern international commerce, as well as Ghana's economic development needs, make engagement with foreign investors in the meantime. Rather, this lecture has argued the need for the government to rethink various aspects of its engagement with international arbitration. The process should start with a review of the statutes, multilateral and bilateral investment treaties, and arbitration agreements that make the government of Ghana amenable to international arbitration. To date, the government's experiences in terms of actual international arbitration claims that have been brought against it has been mixed. A significant number of such claims have been dismissed or were only partially successful. Whichever the outcome, this lecture reveals that the cost of international arbitration to the government have been substantial. It has been suggested in this lecture that the provision in government contracts dealing with the cost of arbitration and how they are to be allocated should be a standard feature of government contracts. Once an arbitration claim is submitted against the government must actively engage in all aspects of the proceedings. There have been instances in which the government's participation in arbitration proceedings has been unsatisfactory. These include lack of full participation in the proceedings, the failure to appoint arbitrators, the failure to retain counsel early in the process to prosecute the government case. There is the need to appoint persons knowledgeable in Ghanaian law or persons from legal systems akin to the Ghanaian legal system as arbitrators for the government. This is especially so when those claims are governed by Ghanaian law. The instances in the past in which the government failed to exercise its right to appoint an arbitrator should be avoided in the future. Similarly, there is the need to engage local council of firms with expertise in international arbitration to complement the work of the Attorney General's Department and any foreign council of firms that may be retained by the government. There is need to repose greater confidence in local council and firms when it comes to dealing with international arbitration claims. It appears from a review of the existing awards and practices that the government, and to some extent, the Ghana Bar, have voluntarily found out the practice of international arbitration to foreign attorneys. This must be avoided. International arbitration will continue to be of increasing importance and relevance to developing countries such as Ghana for decades to come. It is important that the Ghana Bar becomes accustomed to international arbitration. Thank you. Fellows of the Academy, distinguished invited guests, my brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to conclude this lecture with a few acknowledgments. This lecture would not have been possible without the intellectual and personal support I received from many individuals and institutions. I am grateful to the Fellows of the Academy, Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, for my election and the privilege to be part of this eminent institution at such a young age. My deepest and most profound appreciation goes to my parents, Mr. James Kodun Frimpong and Mrs. Mary Jane, for investing in my education and supporting me in diverse ways. I am indebted to my wife, Mrs. Joyce Okunkwoye, and my beautiful girls, Mary, Zoe, and Elizabeth. They provided a peaceful setting in which I wrote this lecture. I acknowledge you. Honorable Student Frimpong versus Solomon Frimpong Martin, Augustine Anne Frimpong, and Jumosia Frimpong, and Mrs. Benedicta Frimpong. I should also mention Dr. Ernest Olusudapa. Although he is not a blood relation, his beneficence to my family and I has risen to the highest heavens, and I deeply celebrate him on earth. Thank you very much. I appreciate the support of my classmates and friends from the University of Ghana, the Ghana School of Law, and especially those from the best secondary schools in Ghana, secondary school in Ghana, Opong. My classmates and friends are too many to mention, but I would be remiss if I did not name the sense of Osupinia Sante, Dr. Prof, A.K.A. Sigma Richard H., and Mr. Justice Osei Fuyi. I am grateful to all the individuals who supplied me with materials or commented on drafts of this lecture. The following person deserves special mention in this regard: Mr. Ferdinand Adani, Mr. Augustus Asante Agima, Ms. Loretta Asante, Nana Dr. S. A. B. Asante, Dr. Abdul Basit Barber, Dr. Justice Samuel Rufida Kibra, Dr. Francis Bushi, the Honorable Mr. Godfrey Dami, Deputy Attorney General, Professor Albert Fiadu, Professor Akela Fasoya, and Mr. Fuiji Kevin. I would also like to acknowledge the presence and support of my former teachers, Professor Mensa Bonsu, Professor Ibi Odama, who wrote a reference for me and enabled me to go to Harvard. And I remember he gave me £100 or so. And Mr. Fuiji Kata, Mr. Raymond Atutuba, and all those presents who I have not been able to acknowledge. I would like to acknowledge the kind sponsors of this lecture, namely Thompson Rivers University, Raydor Chambers, Usudafe and Associates, AB and Navy, Ghana Arbitration Center, Mr. Ishmael Yamsin and Nosley Company Company, and my classmate, Mr. Bright Oxeripekikun. Fellows of the Academy, distinguished invited guests, my brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sincerely grateful for the opportunity to deliver this lecture, for your attendance of this lecture, especially on a holiday, and for your very kind attention. Thank you.
Those who must have been here to hear this lecture. Fortunately, something unusual has happened with this lecture. Some government lectures, we hear them and they blow away like a wind. Last week's lecture by Professor Abusia Mwakamfufu was the number 58 lecture given on the platform of the Academy's Inaugural. This is number 59. Some of the earlier ones have never been published. This one was published even before it was delivered. So all those recommendations, the analysis, they were not theoretical analysis, they were to the point, case by case, and all documented here. I would hope that it's possible for us to make a gentle presentation of copies of this lecture. I don't know where we should start, the Attorney General's Department, the President's Office, Parliament, and especially the ministers who have been given specific responsibility to stop work on various contracts and review them for possible, you know what, that they need to read this first before they conclude their assignment. The implications could be disastrous for us. We thank you very much. Those of us who thought that we were so far away that we didn't know what was happening here, we have to go home and cover our faces in shame. You have been following closely, even with the help of colleagues you have acknowledged. And we are grateful for the analysis, but also taking care that it is in our hands. We can set about distributing it as widely as possible. We thank you for coming. I've already announced a date for the next one. It will be October 10th at the appropriate time. Details of that one will go up. And there are a few others that are lined up for the rest of the 2-3 months or 4 months of this year. Again, we'd like you to come back and bring more of your base the next time. Thank you very much.
President of the Academy, past presidents of the Academy, vice presidents, fellows of the Academy, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, our students, our counselors, you were not going to miss that day. Ladies and gentlemen, I think we've had a very good presentation, and it's opened up to quite a lot of things to think about. My duty here is just to bring some announcements to our attention. On September 19th, 2017, we'll have an annual lecture in the sciences. And this will be delivered by Professor Arthur Sakikyo. The title is Stress and Rest, Pharmacodynamic Modulation for Sustainable Human Health. Don't ask me what to do. If you want to know, come and listen to it. So this is for September 10th at the 19th, 2017, which is a Tuesday. On October 4th, 2017, there will be a public event, and this will be by Professor BJB Nauking. The title is Access to Sustainable and Affordable Energy for All, the Role of Nuclear Energy. So that will also be interesting. And as was announced, on the 10th of October, we'll have another inaugural lecture here. And on 26th of October, we'll have Professor Hans Edutapa giving his inaugural lecture on achieving food and nutrition security through plant breeding. You are all invited to these lectures. I believe that they will really offer the time to understand what is happening around us. On that note, we will rise for the party here to depart. And then the receptions, there will be reception for the family and old boys will be in the right and left foyer. Special guests will be attended to directly outside, and fellows and dignitaries will be refreshed in the fellows lounge. Thank you very much. Shall we rise?
Thank you.